Thank you. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes,
Yes,
ma'am.
ma'am.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yeah, very good morning, morning girl.
Morning, ma'am.
Yeah. So can you see the slide? Hello.
Yes.
Are you able to? Okay, so today we'll discuss Block 10, where we'll discuss the poems of Dylan Thomas, Philip Larkin, and Sylvia Plath. So we have done with nine blocks. We have discussed till modern era, isn't it? Modern age. So today we're going to discuss postmodern age. So what do you know? Tell me, what do you know about postmodern era? Any idea about the postmodern age? Modernism we discussed in the last class. Any idea? Okay, postmodernism is a movement started in the late 20th century as a reaction against modernism. Okay, so in modern during modernist era or during modernism, poets or the writers, they were trying to find some meaning. We know that the entire world is meaningless, but the writers, the poet, they were deliberately looking for a meaning. Now, postmodernism is a reaction against modernism. Okay, so the writers or the scholars of the postmodern era, they are pretty aware of the fact that there is no meaning in this world. The world is essentially chaotic. We cannot fix anything. Okay, so postmodernism refers to a cultural, intellectual, or
Hello,
artistic state.
sound yellow.
Can you hear me? Hello, are you able to
We
hear
can hear
me?
you, ma'am. Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, I told you postmodernism is a reaction against modernism. Both are movements, both are literary movements. So our T.S. Eliot, etc., Ezra Pound, etc., belong to modernism, modern era. See, postmodern era means age after 1915, after two world wars. Age after two world wars. That is why it is said to be post, after modernism. Okay, so nine block poems belong to modern era, modernism. Okay, so the 10th block belong to modernism period, postmodern period. Okay, can you please mute your mic? So, I repeat, during modern era, those writers, even though they are aware that the world is meaningless, they were trying to look for some meaningful things in the world. They were trying to put a unity in this chaotic world through their piece of art. But in postmodern era, their attempt was entirely different. The attempts of the writers, poets were entirely different. We have already discussed that. See, from 20th century onwards, our literature has attained a three-dimensional quality. Actually, writers have no specific role in it. It is the readers who are active. It is the readers who have to fill the space in the literary works. It is because it is they who interpret the work. Last class we have discussed that birth of the reader must be at the cost of the death of the author. Okay, the place where an author dies begins the birth of the reader. Okay, so postmodernism, see, it's a cultural movement or intellectual movement which lacks a clear central hierarchy, or it doesn't have any kind of organizing principle. Okay, and it's full of contradiction, ambiguity, diversity, etc. And see, if you're reading, you won't find any kind of coherence. Of course, it is an extension of modernism, but still unreliable narrators. Narrators will be unreliable. Narrators will be shifting. Then they are not trying to attain any kind of unity. Let me tell you, in last block, we have discussed Wasteland. That is a collage poem, isn't it? We have discussed so many scenarios from different centuries. But in that poem, T.S. Eliot was trying to attain a kind of organic unity. Even though artists, this is scattered work, he was trying to attain a unity. But in this work, in this particular modernist work, they are not trying to attain any kind of unity because they know the world. Yeah, yeah. Tell me.
Hello.
Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am. It is audible.
Okay. So, let me tell you. They are not trying to attain any kind of unity because they know that world is essentially chaotic. That reflected in their works as well. Okay. So, let's see some of the characteristics of postmodern era. So I told you, period after two world wars. So writers, they mostly discuss taboo topics like sexuality, drug, alcohol, then domestic abuse, then cultural identity. Then these writers mostly wrote in free verse rather than, block one, block two, up to block seven, they wrote in heroic couplet and all. They had some rigid rules and all, but in the postmodern era, from modern era onwards, writers are not following any kind of rules. Okay, they are writing in free verse. Now, postmodern poetry. Already we have discussed there is a reaction against modernism. Still, it is an extension. Still, they maintain some kind of features, characteristics in postmodern period. Then irony. So let me tell you, postmodernism employed its features through many literary devices like irony, pastiche, absurdity, hyperreality, etc. Okay, so irony we know. What is irony? Intending something but saying exactly opposite of that. Pastiche. What is pastiche? See, nowadays we are watching a lot of spoof and all. See, reworking of something. For example, I think you are familiar with Great Indian Novel, isn't it? The Great Indian Novel, where the author has uprooted previous character from Mahabharata and he has placed in the present context where Duryodhana has, but Indira Gandhi has been given the image of Duryodhana. But Indira Gandhi is projected as Duryodhana, okay? Duryodhana is the effeminate version of Indira Gandhi. Okay, fine. So like that, Jinnah is presented as Karna. Like that, see, pastiche is a kind of pasting previous existing elements in the modern work. Absurdity means that is no... See, sometimes when you read the more postmodern work, you will think, see, everything is chaotic, no meaning, nothing is connected. Full of absurdity because essentially the present world is full of absurdity. Now, technoculture that you know, because in the modern work you will come across the weird sounds. You will see the phrases like praying or onomatopoeias, like that. Now. So now, loss of faith in politics and moral authority, alienation from society. I told you, every man is an island. Every man in the postmodern era, even though, we are going, we are enjoying life, we are going to party, etc. Every man is an island. Now, black humor, then it is against commercialism. Hedonism, then mass production, economic globalism. So let me tell you, until 19th century, most of the majority of the, I mean, most of the nations were under the control of British Empire. Okay, they were forcefully taken as slaves. But in the present era, what happened? They are willingly working for the capitalist countries. The only difference is, only difference between colonialism and globalization is, see, imperialism was replaced by capitalism, isn't it? Imperialism was replaced by capitalism. Previously, that position was occupied by British. Now, it is occupied by capitalist countries like US, Japan, China, Germany, etc., etc. So now we are willingly working for them. Now we are mechanical in nature. Okay, we have lost their spirituality, that says for life. Hedonism. What do you mean by hedonism? Hedonism means, see, enjoying all the physical pleasures of life. That is said to be hedonistic culture. Now, another feature of the postmodern literary work is that post-war poetry. So I told you, in post-war poetry. Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
So we were discussing the features, characteristics of. Hello, we were discussing the postmodern characteristics.
Oh, okay.
So if you're getting any poems from this block 10, sometime they will ask you, discuss the work as a postmodern poem. If you're getting the poems of Philip Larkin, discuss church going as a postmodern poetry. So if you want to substantiate it as a postmodern poetry, first of all, you should know what is postmodernism. Okay, so that is why we have discussed postmodern characteristics. Now, post-war poetry. So, essentially, as I have already said, we have witnessed two world wars. So many countries, many capitalist countries have become very successful after two world wars. But see, writers belong to these countries. Through their poem, they have they never glorified the victories of their nation. Instead, they talked about the horror, bloodshed, and the great death. So mostly the poems were full of disillusionment. Okay. So the post-war poetry, Philip Larkin, D.J. Enright, Tom Gunn, etc., some of the post-war poets. That is another category of postmodern literary work. Now, neo-romanticism. So let me tell you, it is quite natural that every literary age is quite opposite to that of the immediate predecessors, their immediate predecessors. See, romantics were against neoclassist, isn't it? Then Victorians were against romantics. Then modernist writers were against their immediate predecessors, Victorian writers. Okay. Similarly, every successors, every writers were against their immediate predecessors. So modernist writers and postmodernist writers, they were largely pessimistic. They were mostly discussing about this current social problems and disillusionment in their life. But there is a group of poets known as neo-romantic poets, just like neoclassism. They belong to the first half of the 20th century. They revived the lost romantic elements. Okay, they revived the romantic elements. So our Dylan Thomas belonged to neo-romantic poets. Okay, so I told you this is neo-romanticism is a reaction against realism and intellectualism, or you can say that. Hello, can you please mute the mic? Please mute your mic. Hello, please mute your mic.
No government to tell us.
Hello,
Fabin Isha, please mute your mic. Hello. Fabin Isha, can you please mute your mic? Class, are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we are.
Yes, ma'am.
Fabin Isha, can you please mute your mic?
One second,
let me see what I can do. Okay. So I hope you are clear with neo-romanticism. They revive the romantic element of the 19th century. Okay.
Ma'am, we are getting disturbance due to Fabian. Please tell him or her. I don't understand if she is a he or she. It would be better if he or she. Yeah.
Let me call the center. Okay, it's not me who is holding the who's hosting the Google Meet. It's from the center. I don't know. Even I can't remove her from the Meet. Let me try.
Okay.
Just a second. Let me inform the center. Okay. I'll be back.
Hello, who is this Fabian? Not putting the mic off, please tell anyone.
The phone is bigger, sorry. Children, I think so.
I think she forgot that she is in the classroom.
The center, let me see what I can do.
ഫ്രിഡ്ജിലാക്കണ്ട
She muted, ma'am.
No, okay.
Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Please continue.
Very good.
Yes, ma'am.
So we were discussing neoclassical, neo-romantic element. So I told you neo-romantic poet, they revived the romantic elements, romantic elements of the late 19th century. Actually, this was entirely a new trend in the 20th era, because 20th era writers, they mostly discussed the social, psychosocial problems. Okay, but these people are, least bothered about social problems in society. They were mostly concerned about the nature and the individualistic problems. Okay, one second. Yeah. Yeah, another characteristics of neo-romantic poetry. Okay, predominant element love, then utopian landscape. Utopia, I hope you know the term utopia, ideal society, isn't it? So they were trying to bring back that ideal society that they had long lost, the material elements and all. So they long for that romantic elements. Then, so back and forth narration, just like, see, Dylan Thomas is one of the prominent neo-romantic poets. Okay, in his poetry, you can see some similar elements that of the William Wordsworth. We have discussed prelude, William Wordsworth prelude, where he has discussed, where he has projected nature as the teacher, mentor, and friend. Similarly, in Dylan Thomas poem also, you can see where he is projecting nature as his mother, then, yeah, companion, etc. Then nostalgic element is common in this poems. Okay, nostalgic element is not only common in Dylan Thomas poem, but also in all neoclassic and neo-romantic poems. Okay, and they were entirely against the capitalism, industrialization. They were least bothered about the progress and scientific development in the society. Okay. No. So the poems were full of rich with sentiments, and they compared past era with that of the present era. They juxtaposed everything, their childhood life with that of the adulthood disturbed life. Yeah. Cool. Now. Dylan Thomas. I hope you can see. Can you see the slide? So there are three poets in this block: Dylan Thomas, Philip Larkin, and Sylvia Plath. Okay. So he is the only poet. Let me tell you, almost all poets were against neoclassical, neo-romantic tradition. Okay, I'm sorry, neo-romantic tradition. But he is the one of the few poets who followed neo-romantic tradition. Okay. So, now, his earlier poems, he died at the age of 39. He became very famous through his poem that he has written in his early phase. Okay. Just like, unlike T.S. Eliot, he hasn't discussed any intellectual crisis or in social issues. Mostly, he discussed mostly personal issues, childhood life, a loss of innocence, etc. Now let's see the characteristics of Dylan Thomas poetry. So you can see he has used a lot of mythical allusions in his poems, archetypes, traditional religion, then rural and garden landscape, surrealistic fantasy. Surrealistic means beyond realism. Okay, beyond realism. Now, next one. See, he imported exotic places in his poems. Okay, now, perfect love, youthful beauty, innocence, biblical allusion, metaphoric language, cosmic images. So let me tell you, these are actually features of romantic poetry. That is why poems of Dylan Thomas are said to be neo-romantic poems, exotic elements, sentimentalism, medieval elements, knighthood, love, etc., etc., personal issues, etc., are are romantic elements. See, modernist and postmodernist writers, they never discuss any individual's issues. They are mostly bothered about the problems in the society. That is how Dylan Thomas differ from other writers. Now, common themes: love and sex, self-discovery, birth and death, religion, nostalgic past, childhood, human psychology, and autobiographical elements. Now, the first poem, "And Death Shall Have No Dominion." It's published in 1933, taken from St. Paul's. Yeah, title is taken from St. Paul's Epistle to Romans. So, in this poem, see, he treats death as something different. He says that death is not the end of life, but spirit. See, human spirit can conquer death. Okay, so yeah, the first stanza idolizes mankind, and second stanza emphasizes on God and suffering, and third stanza focuses nature and the very cosmic image. So there are three stanzas in this poem. Now let's discuss major themes of the poem. Death is obviously death is a theme, but he has treated death in a new way. Rather than treating death as fatalistic, he says that human spirit can conquer everything. Death is not the end of anything. Then, perseverance. So he is a poet who believed in a life after death. Okay. So, although, see, postmodern writers, they don't have the tendency to believe in a life after death. They are very practical. So this person, being a romantic, a neo-romantic poet, he believed in such kind of philosophy, that great cosmic philosophy that somewhat aligns with that of Einstein's. What is that? Is equal to mc square. Matter cannot, energy cannot be destroyed. Now be created. Like that, this person, every human being is a kind of energy, isn't it? After the death of the body, the soul joins the cosmic party. Okay, actually, we are becoming something great after our death. When we are alive, we are just a minor entity. But once we die, we join that bigger entity, that is the cosmic. We become the part of the universe. Now, so he in this poem, he glorifies death. Actually, it is something that brings goodness to the human being. All throughout our life, we are suffering, isn't it? We are losing our innocence. Hmm? We are troubled by the adulthood complexities. But after death, we are getting an eternal life. Let's see. And death here solves all our problems in a positive way. Let's see. One second. And death shall have no dominion. And death shall have no dominion. Dead men naked, they shall be one with man in the wind and west moon. When their bones are picked clean and clean bones go, they shall have stars at elbow foot, and they though they go mad and shall be saved. Though they sing, though through the sea, they shall rise again. Though lovers be lost, or love shall not, and death shall have no dominion. So people are afraid of death, isn't it? We are afraid of death. But in this poem, poet says that actually death has no domination in the present world. Death has lost its value or relevance. Why? Because, see, we people have suffered. We are suffering a lot when we are alive. Once we die, we become naked. Because now, when we are alive, we wear the attire of jealousy, isn't it? We wear soul is the actual body, our flesh and bone, etc. are our clothes, isn't it? So we wear the cloth of jealousy, hatred, etc. and all. See, once we die, all these things get dissolved, isn't it? So men become what? Naked. Okay. And they will be cladded in, just like Wordsworth said, they will be cladded in white. They will have stars at their foot. They will turn into something. Haven't you seen in movies and in cartoons where they say that after the death, human beings will become stars in the sky? Similarly, once we die, we'll join the greater cosmic party. Okay, so those people who were mad when they were alive will become sane again. They will become normal people once they die. And those people who suffered in the sea of sorrow, they will rise again. And those lovers who became unsuccessful when they were alive, see, even though they are dead, their love will remain forever. Just like Romeo, Juliet, Leila, Majnu, their love will live long forever. And they will be reunited in the heaven. So death shall have no dominion. So in this poem, poet presents that death has lost its relevance. Okay, because he's a poet who believes in a life after death. Okay, our soul joins that greater cosmic entity. So yeah, the second stanza he says that, see, he discusses about those sailors who got perished in the sea. After their death, they becomes the obviously their bones etc. turns into in poetical imagination, they turns into gems or jewels like that. Thus, they become more precious, isn't it? They become more precious after death. And see, those sailors who got perished in the sea, they are very courageous. Actually, all their sorrows have come to an end after death. All their sorrows have come to an end. Now, in the second stanza, if you have the textbook, you can see that there is a unicorn metaphor. Unicorn is nothing. Unicorn. Okay. There's a unicorn metaphor where poet compares unicorn with that of Jesus Christ. Actually, unicorn, we know that it's a unicorn is a mythical animal with a single horn. And unicorn's horn has got a speciality that it can neutralize poison. It can neutralize poison. Okay. So here unicorn is presented as Jesus Christ, something that can neutralize evil, physical and mental, problems. It can cure both. Now, the third stanza, poet says that, see, all those people are long dead. They are no more worried about the materialistic world or physical elements. They cannot hear the sounds of seabirds or gulls. They are happy. They will be resurrected. They will be resurrected just like daisies. They are pure now. See, all those people who were impure or selfish, malicious, vicious when they were alive, once they die, they will become pure or like daisies. Okay, that is why it is said that when human beings die, they become naked and they were clad in white. They were clad in white, isn't it? They were donned in white. Why? Their soul is now pure. So death is something, see, unlike mourning death. While other poets were, most of the postmodern and modernist writers were mourning death. They were lamenting about the death of people, but this person is celebrating death. Say like it is something good. Actually, it has freed human beings from a prison where we are raging for something, power, money, sex, everything. Now we are freed from such kind of things. Now we are partying with the universe. So that's all about death shall have no dominion. The next poem is Poem in October. So Poem in October is derived from the volume Death and Entrance, where he presents his childhood in contrast to monotonous adulthood life. Okay, so I already told you these are the features of neo-romantic poetry. Okay, so this poem was written in 1944 on the occasion of his 30th birthday. See, this poet has written so many poems on his 10th birthday, 20th birthday, 21st birthday, 25th birthday, like that. This poem was written on his 30th birthday. Now, so there are 7 stanzas made up of 10 lines each. So here in this poem, he presents a contrasting, he compares and contrasts urban life with that of the village life. Okay. So he was born and brought up in Swansea in London. Swansea is a place in London. Later he moved to USA. Okay. So see, he was not that happy about that transformation, but his life, the circumstance has forced him to move from London to USA. So his life has become, his life in USA is now very materialistic, what do you call it? Mechanical in nature. He has lost that zestful life. Once he was in Swansea, he had that zestful life. Now he lost everything. Now his life is full of monotonous elements. Okay. So he compares his present city life, which was which is full of frustration, weariness, with that of the peaceful village life. Now, so yeah, we have already discussed that it is a he compares and contrasts urban life with that of the village life. Now, the poem can be read along with Fernhill. Okay, that is also prescribed in your syllabus. Fernhill. Fernhill is also a poem about childhood days. Similar kind of poems, okay, similar themes. Most of his poems have similar themes. Now, major themes of this poem, of course, nature. Yeah. Just like our Wordsworth, he talks to non-living things. He can talk to non-living things just like Wordsworth speaks to nature, trees, water, river, boats, etc., etc. Our Dylan Thomas is also speaking to birds, I mean sea, hills, mountains, clouds, etc. Okay, so these are his companions. Actually, he is more comfortable with non-living things and nature rather than mingling with human beings. Okay, so nature is a major theme in this poem. Now, nostalgia for the past. He says that his childhood life was very pleasant. Okay, so childhood life was very pleasant, but now he is in a different place. 30th birthday, he is not able to celebrate like that. He had celebrated while he was 10, when he was 10 years old. So he is longing for that heydays, and he is revisiting his fancy. He is revisiting his village fancy, and he is comparing the weather of the fancy with that of the country life. Now let's see poem in October. It was my 20th year to heaven. See, it's very interesting. He compares every birthday or each birthday as steps in ladder to heaven, isn't it? Every year we are getting closer to heaven, isn't it? We are climbing that step to heaven. So he says that it was my 30th year to heaven. Yeah, walk to my hearing from harbor and neighborhood. And Masarkot and Heron, priesthood showed the morning beckon with water praying and call of the seagull and rook and knock the sailing boats on the net web wall. Myself to set food, the second in the still sleeping town and set food. So that was that. It was his 30th birthday. He woke up hearing the sounds from the harbor and nearby woods. So anyway, his sleepy mood is disturbed by the sound of seagulls and brook. So when he woke up, he describes the tides of the sea, water in the sea are praying. They are praying. Okay. So let me tell you, he has decided to take a walk to his village, that is Swansea. So he set his foot. Now, the second stanza, he reached, when he woke up his other residents of the his country, they were sleeping. Okay, so he continued his journey, and in second stanza, we can see that he reached his Swansea, and the very meaning of his name, Dylan, means sea tide. So he's describing his village. Okay, so the village house, he has got a farmhouse. The farmhouse belonged to his aunt, and farms and houses are very common in that village. Okay, now he can see birds and trees, branches of the trees are swaying. So when the wind blows, the branches of the trees are swaying. So he says that all those trees have wings. So his winged dreams, we can say that Dylan Thomas is very creative and imaginative poet. So he says that trees are having, the branches of trees are having wings. Okay, now just a second. Now, so he describes every single thing in his village. See, one thing you have to know, he is not describing any human beings. He is describing the nature. Okay. So, anyway, time has come. He has to move on. So, he is leaving that premises of Swansea. Now, we can see that in the third stanza, he's climbing a mountain, and he reached the summit of that mountain. Now he looks at his village, and he says that, see, everything appears to be very small, and it is a very beautiful sight to look from a top of a hill. Thereafter, he says, he compares the wind, weather at the both side of that hill. He compares the weather in the countryside with that of the weather in the town. Let me say, tell you something. Throughout the poem, we can see that weather, climate is not good, That is the reason why he shifted, he was forced to move from Swansea to town. Okay. And one more thing, actually he really want to be there in the Swansea, but climate or the weather didn't allow him to stay there. It is not the climate, you shouldn't take the literal meaning of the climate, but weather or climate means circumstance, living condition, other circumstance. It is due to his circumstance he was forced to leave that place. So he was very sad about that now. Yeah. Now he discusses the weather about the woods. See, near to his town, there is a forest. He compares that forest to that as a neighbor. Near to his home, there is a wood, there is a forest. I told you, he compares that wood to a neighbor. Okay. So he's discussing about apples, colorful fruits, apple pears, red currants, and blue sky above. Everything is brilliantly colored. So, and he compares these brilliantly colored things with that of the scene that he had while he was young. Okay. But towards the end of the poem, we can see that he realizes all these beautiful things have been lost. Now he has become very he has become not too old, but he has reached a age or reached a position where he cannot take delight in these type of things. But every birthday, on his birthday, he goes back to all those ancient, old stuff like sea, farmhouse, hoses, etc. Now, yes. So as I have told, there are many symbols in this poem. That is heron, gull, sea, forest, hills, mountain, clouds, farmhouse, etc. But throughout the poem, we can see that he hasn't mentioned about any human beings. He's mostly concerned about the nature. Okay, fine. Now the next poem is Fernhill. Fernhill, I told you, this is an semi-autobiographical poem, okay? Where author is eulogizing about his childhood days. Then that Fernhill belongs to his aunt. The poem has got two parts. The first part is he celebrates his childhood days. In second part, he remembers or he realizes that he is no more in that state, or he is not in a in the Garden of Eden. He has lost all those luxuries or amenities or those status as a prince. While he was young, he had a status of a prince. He was not bothered about any problems in life. But when he grown up, now he is pestered with lot of issues. Society is very much corrupted, has got so many family and other problems. Okay. So he's comparing the childhood life with that of adulthood life. In his previous poem, he compares village life with that of town's life. See, Fernhill and poem in October, more or less same type of poem. Okay, alike. Poems are alike. So you can read Fernhill with that of poems in October. Companion poems. Fernhill is an autobiographical poem in which, see, he uses memories of childhood days, journey from innocence to experience, just like a prelude, Wordsworth's prelude. Yeah. Then another myth of the fall of the man. Yeah, but biblical element. The fall of Adam and Eve from the garden. Garden of Eden. Then world of experience. Miserable manhood. Same theme as that of prelude. Okay, same theme as that of prelude. Now, as I was young and easy under the apple boughs, and house and happy as grass was green. The night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb. Golden in the heydays of ice, and honored among wagons, and I was prince of the apple towns. And once below a time, I loudly had the trees and leaves trail with daisies and barley down the rivers of wind for light. So in this poem, he says that when I was young, he had a carefree life under apple trees. And about the little house and happy. See, when he was a little boy, he used to make small, we all used to make small house, right? So his life was green as grass. Green as grass means fresh as grass. Okay. So the night above was dingle starry. Okay. So he is referring to that life that he spent in his aunt's farmhouse, Farnhill. Okay. So that was a beautiful night. See, starry night. He was discussing about the night he had spent in his aunt's farmhouse, that starry night, carefree days. Golden in the heydays of his eyes. Those days were really golden. Honored among the wagons. See, this man. See, it's a farmhouse, right? So they will be having a lot of cars, wagons to fill the fruits and all. So this person used that cart and wagon as his chariot. And he was the prince among the apple towns. So who were his subjects, do you know? Just like I think you people are familiar with this story, Wizard of the Oz. Wizard of the Oz. Similarly, his subjects, he was the prince and his subjects were trees, apple, fox, birds, etc. were his subjects. Okay. And he was the prince among the apple towns. Once below a time, I loudly had the trees and leaves. Trailed with daisies and barley. So he, was so happy to spend his days in that fern hill. Among daisies and barleys down the rivers of wind for light. And he was bathed with celestial light. Yeah. So we have already discussed that his childhood days were golden days. His subjects were birds, foxes, cow, goats, and other animals. See, once again, I'm stressing you, he hasn't mentioned about any human beings, just like poems in October. In this Fern Hill also, he hasn't mentioned anything about human beings. So in the apple town, he was the prince, he was the huntsman, herdsman. He played all roles. Okay. Yeah. Now, so, and he says that in stanza number 3 says that some can be young only once. What does it mean? That means childhood days, that will not last forever, isn't it? One can be young only once. Not sun is permanent, obviously, sun sets and it rises the next day, isn't it? But human beings can be young only once. Unlike sun, we can be young only once. So, yeah. You cannot enjoy the glory. That's even though he was bathed in celestial light while he was in Farnhill, he cannot enjoy that glory forever. So, yeah. Now, he again discusses, in 4 stanza, he again discusses about his childhood fantasies. Now, he fantasied that in his dream, he dreamt that his farm has been carried away by owls. Next day, when he woke up, he saw his farmhouse back with roosters on his shoulder. So here he presents farmhouse as a person. He personified the farmhouse. He personified Fern Hill. Is it possible to carry away the farmhouse? Okay, we can carry away the animals and other harvest and all, but it is not, it is impossible to carry away the farmhouse. So he poet, while he was a boy, he fantasied that his someone has carried away. Owls have carried away the farmhouse. Next day, when he woke up, he has seen his farmhouse has returned with roosters on his shoulder carrying dew. Okay, so why he's having such kind of fantasies? Because he's a boy. That shows the innocence. So he enjoyed all pleasures of that farmhouse just like Adam and Eve before they committed the original sin. Okay. Now, in which stanza he says that now he realizes that, see, poet has grown up. Now he is having a lot of problems. That glorious days have gone. Now, see, now there are no children in that farmhouse. Okay. So now his carefree days have gone. So, he accepts the end of childhood, he compares it that of death. The very birth of manhood, he equates it with that of death. So it is it's inevitable. Death is inevitable, or that a phase of adulthood is inevitable. Unavoidable phase. We have to go through it, isn't it? So he, in this poem, he's eulogizing the childhood days. Remember. So if you're getting an essay question, you can just juxtapose a poem in October with that of Fernhill. I told you, poem in October, poet compares village life with that of town life. In Fernhill, he compares childhood life with that of monotonous adulthood life full of problems. Okay, very simple poem. Now, simples in Fernhill. See, in poem in October, there are a lot of simples like herons, seagulls, rooks, mountain, harbor, woods, clouds, etc. Similarly, there are a lot of symbols. Actually, this poem is full of symbols, okay? So here he says that he prince. He says that he was a prince. Why? See, when you are a king, he never says that he was a king. Why? When you are a king, you will be having responsibilities. Even though you are having a royal status, you have a lot of responsibilities. If you are a prince, of course, you can enjoy the royal status. You can... you are carefree. Yeah, you're totally carefree about all those kind of problems in the country, isn't it? That is why he equates his position with that of prince. And green color, that shows happiness and, the fresh face. White, he was, his days were lamb white days. He says that the days in Fernhill were lamb white days. That means he was as pure as a lamb. Okay. Again, golden color, golden days, fire, time, prince. These are some of the elements. Now, happy as the grass is green. He was as happy as green grass. That means that shows the freshness and what? A longevity. Okay. Now, alive and healthy. Why? Purity and innocence. Innocent shepherd. See, in this poem, he mentioned that he had played herdsman, huntsman, king, etc. So shepherd means shepherds. Okay, Jesus Christ is a shepherd, right? Jesus Christ is a great shepherd. So he equates with that of Jesus Christ. Why? He was as innocent as shepherd or Jesus Christ. Now, so these are the major elements in the symbols in the Fernhill. Now, Next poem is A Refusal to Mourn the Death by Fire of a Child in London. Now, this poem was published in 1945 after the end of two world wars. So let me tell you, in your notebook, in your textbook, maybe they have referred about the death of a child. But let me tell you, it is not the death of a child. They are speaking child here, or the the child here represents those people who had lost their life in two world wars. A refusal to mourn the death. Actually, here poet doesn't want to lament the death of the child. Okay, this poem is about mourning. Here, whether to cry or not. Poet doesn't know whether he should cry or not. A child has burned to death in London. So, who is London's daughter? The child is represented as London's daughter. So, question is this a single person or does she represent a group of people? Actually, she represents a group of people. Okay. So, here poet is not ready to mourn a singular death. Because, see, he belongs to first half of the 20th century, right? So he has witnessed First World War and Second World War and other civil war, Boers War, etc. So many issues like that, isn't it? Wars and other bloodshed atrocities like that. So now he has become what he called numb. He doesn't know whether to cry or not. Or see, mourning has lost relevance in the present world. Because this is not going to end today or tomorrow. This is an endless process. Nation will call for war. People will fight against one another and they will die. So what is the relevance of crying for a person or a group of people? Okay, this poem demonstrates inability to fully register the death of another. Even though we want to cry, see, people are losing their dear ones. They wanted to cry. But our poet has lost that ability to mourn for the death or the dead person. Okay. It shows stoicism, numbness. Stoicism means numbness, insensitivity. Okay. So poem is divided into four stanza of six lines each. Now let's see the major themes of this poem, death and destruction. So, occasion of this elegy, I told you this is a lamentation, a poem that mourned the death of a child or a group of people. Okay. So, a child has been killed in an air raid in London during Second World War. That is the occasion of the poem. Okay. So, see, he says that if he mourns the death of the child, then it will be defaming the child, the glory of the death. Actually, just like in the previous poem, death is actually providing a solace or an end to all sort of problems on earth. So, and then the next theme is loss of innocence and youth. So death of child, see, refusal to mourn the death. Death of child, as in Fernhill, can be seen as loss of innocence. See, in Fernhill, he presents that childhood days have gone, those heydays have gone, golden days have gone. He equates the very end of the childhood with that of death. Man or human being is literally dead. Because no more he is able to enjoy the extraordinary elements or those kind of beautiful things in the world. Human beings are very much pestered with the social problems or day-to-day issues in life, isn't it? So they lost the innocence. So death of the child can be also seen as loss of innocence in the heart of people in the modern world. Then futility of the hour. So he says that he lost the ability to lament the death. That shows futility. There is no point in crying for anything. Okay. It's not going to end. It will continue. We human beings are totally hopeless and helpless in the present scenario. Now, transformation. Yeah, that is the common theme. Just like in death, shall have no dominion. He once again presents that. Actually, see, the poet shall never mourn the glorious death of the child. Why it is said that glorious death? Death is actually something great. It is, as he mentioned in death shall have no dominion, you are becoming a part of a something bigger, isn't it? You are joining water, you are joining cloud, you are joining nature. So why should he mourn? I mean, man will die only once. See, he is already dead. He is already dead. Once he passes his childhood phase, he's already dead. Then why should he cry? Actually, after death, through death, one is getting reunited with that timeless, unity of nature. Now, yes. So, the one second, let me see. Having copied. So as we discussed, the first section, he was crying, he says that there's no point in lamenting the death of the child. And in second stanza, he will only understand that feeling, whether he should cry or not, only when he dies. Until unless he enters Zion. Zion is again, see, kingdom of heaven. He will not understand that feeling, the feeling of being dead. He will not understand it unless he enters Zion. So he says that shedding. See, if you have textbook, you might have come across the word salt seeds. He doesn't want to sow salt seeds. There is no point in shedding salt water. It cannot bring those dead people back. So what is the very point of crying? Okay. And even if he sheds, shed tears, what? See, the ground will remain barren. Nothing is going to germinate or grow. The girl or the child that is dead, or the people who have been killed in the First World War and Second World War, they will not come back to life. So there is no point in lamenting. Now, again, in the last four stanza, he says, he glorifies, as I said, he glorifies death. Now, I told you, childhood phase, he equates with that of Adam and Eve. So if the child has died young, then she or he should be considered as very lucky or fortunate enough, that because he has joined, or the particular person has joined the forefathers. They are now not pestered with the difficulties or problems of life. River Thames is admoning. See, if someone dies, nothing is going to stop. World will go as usual, isn't it? Let it be the president of America or India, or let it be the head of world nations. Nothing is going to stop, or nothing is going to change. Everything will continues as usual. Okay, everything will continue as usual. Fine. So that is the main gist of the poem. What? Refusal to mourn the death of a child in London. Now, he has used so many religious and biblical elements like Zion, synagogue, etc. Doomsday. He says that mourning the death will be blasphemy. It will be like questioning or acting against God, because death is God's will. And so why should we lament death? Actually, it is putting an end to all kind of problems on earth. So we should celebrate death. Okay. Now. Next poem. Next poem that is included in the block 10 is Philip Larkin. Philip Larkin is a movement poet. Remember, Dylan Thomas is a neo-romantic poet. Philip Larkin belongs to movement poet. Movement, okay. Movement is a movement. Okay, movement. Now, Larkin is a pessimistic poet. Let me tell you, he's a pessimistic poet. He was deeply influenced by the novels and poetry of Thomas Hardy, a Victorian, even though he lived both in last half of the 19th century and the first half of the 20th century. He was largely classified as a Victorian poet, Thomas Hardy. So Philip Larkin was influenced by Thomas Hardy. Now, this person has become famous through his poems like Church Going, Wits and Wedding, etc. And Philip Larkin, by profession, he was a librarian, and he died in 1985, and he was unmarried. So I told you he belonged to the group of poets called movement poets. Okay. Anyway, the term was coined by J.D. Scott in 1954. A group of poets who belong to this circle were Kingsley Amis, Donald Davy, D.J. Enright, John Wayne, Elizabeth Jennings, Tom Gunn, Robert Conquest, etc. So these poets were against that Bourgeois class. Bourgeois class means mediocre class. See, let me tell you, society can be divided, okay, can be stratified, upper class, lower class, Bourgeois class, upper middle class. So let me tell you, all writers were against this bourgeois class, middle class, because according to writers, they were the most vicious, cunning, manipulative class, petted. I mean, bourgeois class. So these group of poets were against the hypocrisy, cunningness, or rituals, some kind of system. I mean, those people who are trying to bring any kind of orders or such kind of rules and regulations in society, because they know that world is not like that. World is going to be very chaotic or even worse than that. It is absurd, meaningless. World is full of hopelessness, despair, nothing new. So what is the very point in bringing some kind of systems, rules, regulations, etc.? So they were against such things, industrialization, such kind of capitalist policies and all. So movement poets were against capitalist policies. Okay, they mostly wrote about working class people. I think you people have done with MEG too, right? British drama. Hello? Are you people there? Yeah, so you people might have done gone through MEG2, where you have discussed one of the working class. What is the title of that drama that you have done in MEG2? MEG2.
Look Back in Anger, ma'am. Kitchen Sink Drama.
Yeah, Kitchen Sink Drama. Look Back in Anger. It mostly discusses about the proletarian class, working class group, isn't it? Proletarian. So these writers mostly concentrated about the issues of the proletarian class or working class. Yeah. John Osborne's Look Back in Anger, isn't it? Yeah. Fine. See, let me tell you, Philip Larkin and other movement poets were against neo romantic poets, okay, neo-romantic. They know that there is no romantic elements in the present context, isn't it? Everything is gray and dull. Everything is bleak. Yeah. So essentially, the movement was a reaction against extreme romanticism and surrealist detachment of the neo-apocalyptic like Dylan Thomas. Now, yeah. So on the other hand, these movement poets, they reconstructed neoclassicism, a general treatment of direct movement, direct comment involvement in politics and social doctrine. Yeah, these people are mostly interested in discussing social psychological issues. Now, see, by 1950-1960, England has returned, isn't it? England has lost its power in the world, isn't it? England lost most of his colonies, especially lost his control over India. Actually, India was the pivotal among the colonies. England's colony, India was the pivotal. So 1947, India became independent, isn't it? India got independence. After that, see, there started the very decline of England in all realms of life, in politics as well as in economics. England lost its what? Dominance. So they were mostly discussing such issues. Yeah. Now, and see, in the poems of moment poems, you can see day-to-day day-to-day issues and languages were colloquial. Okay, I mean words were colloquial because they discuss the problem of the modern man. They are not discussing the story of king, queens, or knights. They discuss. They are really interested in the problem of modern man, and they know that there is no solution or end for that. See. I think you are familiar with John Keats. In his poem, he says that truth is beauty and beauty is truth. And Philip Larkin says that, see, life is not like that. You life is not always beautiful, or one cannot remain truthful to everything or everyone always. Okay. So he is against such kind of romantic elements. So their poems will be full of sarcasm, black humor, irony, parody, pastiche, etc. So that is why before learning postmodern poems, you should learn postmodern elements. You should go through postmodern movement. What is postmodernism? What are the technical devices or literary devices that poet use to employ or to highlight such elements? So you should check what is hyperreality. Those kind of reality we cannot accept. Another one, maximalism, minimalism. Metafiction. Self-reflexive narration. Unreliable narrator. See, let me tell you, in the modern context, we cannot fix anything. We cannot say, this leads to another, or this is the cause for that problem. We cannot find any solution or any what root reason for anything. Everything directs to everything else. Okay. Everything is interconnected. That is why I said we are living in a chaotic world. Now, let's discuss church going. See, church going is a very famous poem. Written by Philip Larkin in 1954, published in 1955. The title itself is a pun. It's a wordplay. What do you mean by pun? P-U-N, pun. We have already discussed about pun while we discussed the poem Caller by George Herbert, isn't it? Church going is a pun because it talks about going to church at first context, going to church in the second context. See, the very faith is going, maybe faith about church or in religion, it is fading. Two meanings. Okay. I hope you got the relevance of the title, church going. It is a fun. In the first context, it means go simply going to church. In the second context, the very belief or the very faith in church is going, is getting faded. Okay, so the poem church going represents the thoughts of the poet as he enters a church. He is not a believer, he's a non-believer. Okay, still he believes that okay, religion is good for the humankind. Okay, now, yeah, he enters the church just like he enters a museum. Okay, he enters it not out of that faith, but he just wants to see what's inside the church. Let's see. Okay. To inquire the role of the religion in our daily life. Now, so there are seven stanza and the rhyming scheme A, B, A, B, C, A, B, C, D. Okay. Now, let me tell you, this is a satire. This is a satire. Now, in the end of the poem, narrator, our poet or the speaker, comes to a conclusion, okay, in the modern context, church has, even though church has lost its relevance or importance, religion has lost its importance, still there are some people or majority of the people stick to faith, church, etc. because it is a need. It is a need. It not out of faith or not because of their belief in that, but it is a necessity. It's a need of the time. That is why we are going to church. Okay, so major themes in church going, religion, then established church, need to worship, ceremony of rituals for a future of church, superstition and religious feelings. So, yeah, we have already discussed the title, church going. See, this is a serious poem. Also, this is a sarcastic poem. Okay. So, this person, our speaker or the poet enters the church. See, just to see what is inside the church. Just like entering the museum. So, everything in that church looked untouched. And he can sense, he can feel the antiqueness in that church. Because, see, that church is least used. People are coming on all Sundays to observe the holy day, holy mass and all. But church still look untouched. Okay, so let me tell you, he's actually mocking that entire belief system. Now, see, the benches, the baptismal font, then altar, dried flowers, etc. Some of the symbols that is used in the poem. You can see the dried flowers, then dust on the bench, etc. That means, see, people are coming and going. Okay, it is Sunday. We should go to the church, come back. Like that. So after observing the church, he signs in a ledger book and he donates six Irish pence and he returns. Okay, then he goes to the churchyard and all. So he has seen, even though in coming days church will lose its relevance, these places will be overgrown with trees and moss and algae. Okay, but still there are some people, or there are so many dubious ladies or superstitious ladies. See, some people believe that if you touch and pray on the stone or the tomb of a particular person, you will be healed, you will get particular power. There are such kind of people. So he is, in this poem, he is analyzing, exploring people, different types of people, why they are going to church. What were the very faith of church, the very future of church and church-related things. Okay, so he says that in coming days, more and more people will lose their faith in church or the institution of church. Okay, But still there will be some people who are superstitious. They will go to church because it's a part of their it's a part of their life. Not out of belief, but because of the practice. It is their practice. Just like you're going to gym, you're going to museum, like that, they will go to church. Then, So in this poem, he discusses who could be the last person who has visited this church. Maybe someone like him, some antiquarians, some librarians like him. See, in coming days, people will go to church. Our younger generation or the coming generation will go to church, not to pray, but they will be those people who are interested in antiquity, antiqueness, a lover of antiquity. Sometimes one or two, those who are addicted to church, maybe they will visit. But he says that church will be there. It should be there because some kind of order is necessary. Because we human beings remain sane. At least we are following some kind of what? Humaneness, or we are having some kind of humaneness just because of that, not the faith. We cannot say that this faith, because we are afraid of those stories mentioned in Bible, fables. The evil will be punished, and the good will be rewarded. Such kind of belief system that makes the people to go to church. Okay. Now, next poem is I Remember. This is also an interesting parody. Let me tell you, Dylan Thomas Wordsworth, they were celebrating childhood days. Okay, childhood days were very beautiful, innocent, so and so golden days. But this person is entirely opposite. Okay, let's see. Written in 1954, published in 1955. So he happened, just like in Prelude, Wordsworth traveling in train, he stops by his country hometown. Here, this person accidentally stops by his hometown, Coventry, where he was born and raised. So somebody asked him, where he does he belong to this place? Anyway, he was not that happy when the particular person asked about his hometown, because according to Philip Larkin, childhood is such a phase where nothing will work. See, this poem is a kind of, it's very interesting. It's a kind of, it's a comedy. If you read Dylan Thomas, try to read this poem after reading Prelude and Fernhill poems in October, you will laugh. Okay, he says that childhood is such a phase where nothing will work out. Nothing will work out. Why? See, just like other poets who had golden days by the riverside, in the forest, hunting and all, this poet never has a colorful life. Okay, this poet never had a colorful life. While other teenagers were celebrating their lives, their parents were having Ford car. Okay, that is mentioned. Their parents were having very expensive cars and luxurious lifestyle. This person was longing for such type of amenities in life. He was longing for that. Okay. Now, when he entered the adolescent period, he got attracted to a beautiful girl. He really wanted to make love with her, but because of that boyish anxiety or that type anxiety issues, he couldn't really make it out. Okay, he couldn't really make it out. So that is why he blames childhood. It's such a phase where nothing is going to happen. Okay. So why should he celebrate childhood? You understood, his childhood was really unhappy. So you can compare and contrast the poems of Dylan Thomas and Philip Larkin. Very interesting. Themes in the poem, unspent memories, unspent adolescence. And this person doesn't hold any root to that hometown. Unlike the Dylan and Wordsworth. See, they are very happy to go to Swansea. See, one is our Dylan Thomas belong to Swansea and our Wordsworth belong to downtown. Okay. Derwent. He's from the Lake City of London. So they are very full spirited to go to their hometown. Waiting to reach the hometown, how to spend. They are calculating how I will spend my days. I want to get those days back. I want to enjoy. I want to go to the woods, river, just like I had fun while I was a boy. But this person says, it's, even when his friend asks him, do you belong to this place? He got irritated. Why? He doesn't hold any beautiful memory. Now, as I told, he has used very reflective tone, personal pronoun, then colloquial language. Elusive. He has taken a reclusive type tone, not attached, but he's detached. Now, next poem is Blaney. Blaney is a, let me tell you, Blaney is an another autobiographical poem. It was first published in 1955 along with Whitsun Wedding. Okay. So let me tell you, Blaney is none but poet himself. And Blaney can be any person, not only the poet, can be any person in the modern era who is meddling with the adulthood problems. So themes are loneliness, isolation, dullness, lack of creativity, life full of complications, ambitionless life, hopelessness. So these are the major themes of Blaney. Okay. So in this poem, he is discussing about a clerk who is not that rich, not a rich fellow. Our poet happened to, live in a room who was previously occupied by the person named Blaney. So Blaney is a very unattractive, monotone. It was an unattractive man who was having a monotonous life. Okay. But let me tell you, he doesn't have many companions, but he mingled. His only entertainment was the radio, the news or songs from the radio which he heard from his. Once again, can you please mute your mic? Someone has turned on the mic. Please mute the mic. Okay. Please mute the mic. Okay. Has turned on the mic. Subhan Sahu, please turn off the mic. Please mute your mic. Hello, can you hear me? Once again. Oh, sorry. Just a second. So we have discussed. Okay. So I told you Blaney is poet himself. It can be Blaney can be any man who has lost interest in life, who is leading a monotonous life. So the only entertainment that Blaney had was the radio song that he heard from the house of the house owner. And see when he entered the room of Mr. Blini, that person, he says that he was really such a colorless life. Later he understood that Mr. Blini was having a much more colorful life than the poet, because actually even though he had only some a few connections in life, he was happy and contented with that. A small poem, okay. So as I said, this is an autobiographical poem. Philip Larkin is unmarried, okay? He's not married. He was also living like Blini in a small room in the attic of a lady. Then it's a dramatic monologue. Then what else? So it also, the very nature of the poem is full of pessimistic elements, okay? Because he was discussing the very character of Blini, how such a person, how one can live such a life like Blini without having much connection with the external world, only a few connections like with the landlady, two or three friends, then his sister. But towards the end, author says that Mr. Blini's life was much more colorful than that of the author, our poet. Or else we can say that Blini is none but poet himself. Because both Blini and Philip Larkin, they were both isolated or were leading a reclusive life. Now, thoughts. Another poem by Philip Larkin. In this poem, thoughts actually refers to those people who are working from morn till evening. So in this poem, he is blaming the very stagnation of life. See, he got very trapped in that library. Morning till evening, he has to sit in that library, turning the pages, filling the ledger book, etc., etc. So he has sacrificed his life for the work. So now he is full of jealousy. See, when he looks at those people who is celebrating life in the park, pub, etc., he's full of jealousy. How those people are enjoying life, and here he is sacrificing. So this poem is dedicated to those people, those clerks, those officers who are sitting with files, taught life.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah, tell me.
Yes, screen share has stopped, I suppose.
Okay, ma'am. Let me share it once. Let me try. Now, are you able to see? Hello?
No.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, can be seen.
Okay. So I told you, Todd is dedicated to all those people who are working in the office from morn till evening, who are toiling. Okay. That is why it is said to be life is way full of monotonous elements. Nothing new. Working and eating, working and sleeping. So, yeah, dissatisfaction, freedom and confinement, cunning and cleverness, dream, hopes and plans. So these are the major themes in thoughts. Okay, now, so a small poem, okay, Toad's Revisited. So let me tell you, this is a second poem, a companion poem of Toad. Just like Milton's poem, companion poems, we have discussed two Milton, L'Allegro and El Penisro, right? We have discussed two poems similarly. Toads and Toads Revisited are two companion poems. In one poem, see, Toad, he has written while he was young. And Toads Revisited, he wrote this when he became a little bit matured, because now he understood the relevance of Toad work. See, only those people will be able to live in the present world who are hardworking. Only those people who are hardworking can live in this world. Actually, even though it is tedious, miserable, but it works. Okay. So it is published in 1964 along with the Whitsun Wedding. His attitude to work has changed. So you can compare and contrast. Both are companion poems, but contradictory themes, contradictory views. Okay. So themes are work life, morality, immorality, and boredom. Yeah. So let me tell you, in this poem, going to work, he treated it as morality. It's a part of person's morality that one should go to work. Okay, grown up, you cannot waste your life like that. It is your duty to go to work. It's better to work than wasting it idle. Okay. So the theme is entirely different. Okay. Now I'm moving. This is it's almost 11:45. You can see elements of anger, frustration in this poem, because while he is toiling, other people are enjoying life. But towards the end of the poem, you can see that he states that those people are really wasting their life, or else those people who are wasting their life by partying or going to park or disco, they are actually leading an immoral life. Actually, this poem is against his own tradition, because Philip Plotkin and a set of other writers are against any kind of such kind of systems, rules, and regulations in society. But in this poem, he says that, yeah, working is a moral part of life. That is a morality. Now, Atgrass is about, was published in 1955, along with the collection Less Deceit. Let me tell you, here, hose is used as the metaphor. Hose, raising hose is used as the metaphor. So he was inspired by a newsreel film on Brown Jack, the racehorse, in his retirement. Okay, so rose here, raising horses are compared to ancient or their glorious or great forefathers, forefathers in army, military, and navy. While they were young, they were leading a very they were having a very active life. They controlled the society. They had power. They had power, status, money, everything. The entire attention were on those people, isn't it? Those people, president, then general, such kind of people who hold great status in society. So while they are young and once they are in power, the entire attention was on those people. But once they superannuated, once they are retired, once they become old, they will lose all those glories, those status, power, attention, money. They will be unnoticed or unchecked by society. Okay. So their situation is compared with that of the raising horse. Isn't it? See, those racing horses, when they are young and powerful, when they have the stamina, people will gamble with them, isn't it? People will bet on them. People will cheer for those horses. See, entire attention will be upon them. Okay. But what happened when they get superannuated? No one will be there to attend them. They will be left in the meadows. They will be great. Okay. So these horses are least bothered, even though they lost those status as the race horse. They are not bothered. See, they are happy grazing grass in the meadows. So they compare here. Philip Larkin compares race horses with that of the English ancestors, those famous generals, presidents. They are contented with their life. They have done what they can in their lifetime, isn't it? Now they can retire. Now they can rest. So these horses, now they are in meadows grazing. Now they are waiting for the groom boy. I mean, the one that tend them, one who gives them grasses or, one who attend them. On other side, the groom boy can be death. They don't have anyone to wait for. See, these race horses who are grazing in meadows, they don't have anyone to cheer them up, to bet on them. Okay, except that groom boy who comes and tend them. That groom boy can be death. That means these race horses are waiting for their death. And they are happy. They are peaceful. They are contented because they have accomplished what they want in their life, what they wanted in their life. So let me tell you, this is a heavy dose of pessimism. Okay, the poem is full of pessimistic stuff. Actually, all poems of Philip Larkin is full of pessimism, dark, bleak. Bleak tone. Actually, this is the pathetic side of human life. Now, old age, themes in that grass. Old age, loneliness, memory, loss of British Empire. Yeah. So, it not only talks about the English ancestor, it also talks about the British Empire, isn't it? After 1960-1950, British Empire has lost its glory. Once it had so many colonies, like India, Africa, Australia, and Ireland, people held them, I mean, held those English ancestors of British Empire with respect and awe. But once they lost the authority or colonies, now they have, or it has the same fate of racehorse. Okay. Now another poem, it's Vixen Wedding. So Vixen Wedding is also a sarcastic poem in which he satirizes rituals, beliefs, or certain practices in society, especially marriage. Philip Larkin is, remember, Philip Larkin is unmarried. Okay. So let me tell you, Vixen Day, the day on which, on this particular day, British government frees marriage tax for one day. On this particular day, British government frees taxes. Okay, so on this day, so many people get choose this day to get married because they can save money, isn't it? So this attitude has been satirized in the poem Vixen Wedding. So Vixen Wedding is the seventh Sunday after Easter. Okay, this is the seventh Sunday, Whit Sunday or Vixen Day. So in this poem, he's describing the journey with brides and grooms after wedding. See, let me tell you, he's a librarian, right? So after his work daily, he travels in a, he used to travel in a train. So most of the poems are written in his journey in the train. Okay. So here he happened to see so many brides and grooms boarding the train, and other people have come there to see of them, and they are giving them set of advices. Some are happy, some are crying, etc., etc. So Philip Larkin is very curious to see such kind of things in society, and he's also ridiculing them because for choosing such a day as day for the marriage. See, there is no point in calling each and everyone for the marriage because, see, we call our dear and near ones, apart from that, our neighbors, also in the distant circle to the marriage, isn't it? So Philip Larkin is asking, see, perhaps we won't see some of them after that in our life, after marriage. See, marriage, birthday party, such kind of things are a kind of reunion, isn't it? Kind of reunion. But after that ceremony, maybe some of us will never meet in life. So why they are holding such kind of things? There is no point, because we are not going to keep a relation forever. Even this bride and grooms, they will not be together forever in their life. Maybe that will end up in a divorce or something like that. So he is very curious about such kind of practices in society. So this is a satirical poem. Okay, so major themes, class, country. He talks, mostly talks about the lower class people. Here he is satirizing the lower practices of lower class people. It is those people who are very much, mediocres, middle class people and lower class people who are bothered about the Whitsun day, because they are the one who choose this day for their wedding. Okay, so he says that marriage is a kind of a farcial, a burlesque, a comical drama. He sees it as a comedy. Okay, see, bride and attendees. See, let me tell you, he watches that marriage procession or bride and grooms just like he is watching a Shakespearean romantic comedy. Because there is no point. Now, another point is country and city life. So these bride and bridegroom got into the train from the countryside. Now they will reach the city and the life will be entirely different. They will be fascinated by the country. See, those brides who got married to the city, of course, in a year or two, they will get fascinated by the city life. Of course, they will lose touch with their parents or with their partners. Okay. Now, the next one is the context of next context is marriage and love. So he takes a cynical attitude towards marriage. Because already I have discussed that he sees wedding as a farcical ceremony, artificial costume, embarrassing family members. See, what's the very point of crying at the time of seeing of some person? Pointless, totally pointless. Next time, the very next moment, they'll be happy, they'll be celebrating, they will be having tea or something like that. So these things are just show off. Now, other religious thing like religious wound. He even ridicules the sarcastic religious wound, which is the bleeding of virgin bride. See, Victorian England, unlike Victorian England, uphold that morality at the highest level, and that still continued in the first half of the 20th century. Now, unlike American writers or American society, British society or English society upholds their moral side. Okay. Now, isolation. See, this person, we have already discussed many of his poems like Blini, Todd Revisited, I Remember, etc. He is a recluse. He's totally alienated, isolated from the other people. That is why he sees everything from the eyes of a stranger. He says that it's a precarious community, very dangerous community. Those people who participated in the wedding ceremony, he calls them precarious or a dangerous community. Now, I will sum up this in 10 or 5 minutes, okay? Okay, next poet is Sylvia Plath. She's a confessional poet. Wife of Ted Dukes. I think you are familiar with Ted Dukes, animal poet, very famous animal poet. She married to Ted Dukes, Sylvia Plath. She committed suicide by placing her head in the oven. Thrice she tried to commit suicide, but her third attempt became very successful. And this person, she suffered from Electra complex. She had a kind of father fixation, Electra complex. In all these poems, in all her poems, we can see the influence of her father. Okay, so yeah. Anyway, her father was a German, and he was a professor at in a college in USA. And her mother was the student of her father. Okay. Now let me tell you, Daddy Colossus, Ariel, etc. Lady Rezares, etc. Some of the famous poems of Sylvia Plath. Now she was a brilliant student. She got scholarship. That's how she came to England, and she joined Cambridge University, where she met Ted Dukes and fell in love with him and got married. See, while she was doing her graduation, she tried to commit suicide, but that was unsuccessful. After marrying Ted Dukes, she begot two children from him. In 1963, she committed suicide. See, after having two kids, Ted Dukes left Sylvia Plath for another poet, and 6 months later, she committed suicide. So let me tell you, she suffered from depression and father fixation. And Belja is her last Swan's work, or Swan's, that's her Swan song. Last work, Belja. Okay, so common theme in Plath's poetry. Common theme in Sylvia Plath's poetry. Feminist. Okay, some feminist protest, humanitarian protest against Nazi atrocity. Let me tell you, when you read the poem, sometime you will you may have some kind of doubt that whether her father is a Nazi. No, her father is not a Nazi. Well, let me tell you, he's only from Germany. But this girl being a bit weird, she presented her father as a Nazi supporter. Okay. Just because he holds German citizenship, she says that her father is a Nazi supporter, and she is also partially German. Okay, then identity crisis. Of course, almost all those people who had migrated to some other country will have identity crisis. Multiculturalism, isn't it? We know that America originally belongs to Red Indians. It is the white, those white people are settlers. So multiculturalism, but that's one of the features of American society. So almost all people, modern generation, people in the modern generation, they have identity crisis due to their hybrid nature. Then psychological trauma, nervous breakdown, childhood memories, death and suicide, oppression and empowerment, etc. Some of the major themes, common themes in her poetry. Okay. And she has used lot of Roman Greek mythologies in the poem, where she has equated herself and her father to Roman deities, Roman and Greek deities. See, block 10, even though poems have got lot of stuff, if you go through, if you learn the common themes of these poets, it's easy to cover all these poems. Yeah, you have more than 10 poems, I think. Yeah, somewhat 17 or 16 poems are there in the block. But go through the themes first. First of all, you master the characteristics of the poetry, common themes, nature of the poet. Then go to the poem. It will be easy for you. What is confessional poetry? So confessional poets are those poets who discuss the personal issues in life. Say, like, there are certain topic that we don't discuss openly. Okay, during those days, we don't. Nowadays, we are discussing things openly, like death, trauma, depression and all. But back in 1940s, that was a new trend to discuss personal issues. Intimate issues like death, trauma, depression, infidelity in life. marriage life, etc. So it's a genre of poetry identified in the decades immediately after Second World War. Yeah, after Second World War, 1960, 1950, etc. It was initiated by the publication of Robert Lowell's Life Studies. So this trend came into being after the publication of Life Studies by Robert Lowell. And the most noted poet in conventional realm are Sylvia Plath, Theodore Roosevelt, and Annie Sexton. So let's see what is confession. We have seen what is confessional poetry. So mostly these poets took first person. They followed first person narrative in the poem using first person pronoun like I, me, my. Okay, they explored intimate topics as we discussed, love, affairs, suicide, fear of failure, violent trauma, violent thoughts towards family members, trauma, etc. Now, one second. Traits of Plath confessional poetry. Let's see what's typical about Sylvia Plath. Of course, as we discussed, first person narration, I, me, my. Okay. She mostly described the stuff from first person point of view. Autobiographical, okay. Almost all her poems are autobiographical in nature, and the center figure in her poems was her dad, her father, sometimes her husband. Now, Colossus. See, the poem was published in 1960. In this poem, we know that Colossus is one of the ancient world wonders, isn't it? You might have seen that picture on internet or in the books, isn't it? The giant figure of Colossus standing in the city of Rhodes, showing light to ships from Mediterranean Sea, isn't it? That's a famous sculpt. So in this poem, she is mourning the death of her father. Let me tell you, see, if you have gone through the MEG 101 question paper, you might have seen that she is calling, she is against her dad. She is using bad words at her dad. She is not actually against her dad. She is sad because her dad hasn't taught her how to live without him. See, Sylvia Plath lost her dad when she was young. While she was 10 years old, she lost her dad. And in all her poems, she is actually scolding her dad. Oh, you are so cruel. You are so brutal. Daddy, you bastard. She has called so many jargon, so many terms like that. Reason is, she is not actually against her dad, but I repeat, her dad hasn't taught her how to live in the modern society without him. Actually, let me tell you, it is from our mom that we receive that intellectual elements, isn't it? The intellectual side of, is received from mother. A child receives intellectual side from mother, and the courage and how to face the society, the courage and endurance. That part is received from father, isn't it? Yeah. So Sylvia Plath hasn't got such kind of support from her father as he had died in a very while she was 10 years old, isn't it? That is the reason why she is angry. She says that she is suffering just because she is suffering. She is having all kind of problems in the society. She doesn't know how to mingle with people. She doesn't know how to face problems. That reason is her father hasn't taught her. Got it? So, yeah. So, see, she is discussing all these kind of bizarre, exaggerated, nightmarish elements in the poem. And Colossus, that is a giant figure from Greek mythology, right? So she equates her dad with that of Colossus. Let me tell you, in ancient world, that was a world wonder. In ancient society, that was a world wonder. It had a great prominence in the ancient world. But now Colossus doesn't exist, isn't it? Colossus doesn't exist. It has broken. It has fallen down, isn't it? Similarly, her dad also lost relevance. Okay. So the main theme of this poem is parental influence, personal struggles. Yeah, you see this? I shall never get you put together. See how the Colossus statue has been shattered into pieces, just like her dad. Her dad had died, and now she is trying to put it together, but she can't. It is impossible. It's proceeding from, see, mule, brave, pig, grunt, body cackles proceed from your great lips. So she's saying that her dad had called her so many names. It's not. See, most of the things that she discusses in the poem, see, that is not real. Okay, that is not real. That is all hallucination. She is not a normal poet, okay? She suffered from depression, bipolar disorder and all. So whatever stuff she is discussing in the poem, that is created. All those things as a result of her mental depression. Now, perhaps you consider yourself an oracle, mouthpiece of dead, of some god or other. 30 years now, I have labored to wrench the silt from your throat. I am none the wiser. See, dad, she compares her dad with that of yourself, an oracle. Only those prominent people or other powerful people are able to give oracle, right? So she says that her dad was, she believed that her dad was a god, but he died. You know, I am laboring. I have been laboring for 30 years. That means she is now 30 years. She has been leading a life without him for 20 years. See, I am none the wiser. Without you, I don't know how to live in this society. But you won't get that stand. When you read, she is blaming her dad. Oh, he's such a cruel person. He had tortured her a lot. When you read the poem, you will get such a, such kind of indications. But things are not like that. Actually, she loves her father, but she is very much frustrated because she lost him. Now, so in this poem, she's trying to fix the statue of Colossus. She's passing through the bros and entering the ears of the great statue, trying to fix it. Now she understood that the great statue has lost the importance in the present world, because it belongs to the ancient world wonders, just like that, just like her father belonged to the, old society. Now her father is no more. Okay, now, so the themes, gender and oppression, power and myth-making, death and memory. Yeah, so these are the major themes. Power and myth-making means, so daddy, the next poem, okay. Daddy, the center figure is her dad. So here also she continues the same theme, daddy. She calls bad names at her dad. Here also she presents herself as a girl with Electra complex. But when she published it, when she has given an interview for BBC radio, she says that she presented it in the form of a third person narrator. Okay. So in this poem, he presented her dad as a Nazi supporter, someone who oppressed her. Okay, so another theme is power and myth-making. I told you he compares her dad with that of deity. Similar theme with that of Colossus. Okay, and she presented herself as Electra. Okay. Electra and her dad as Admiral, and her mom as Clytemnestra. So in this poem, she is trying to reunite with her dad. I told you thrice she committed suicide. You know why she has committed to suicide? Because she wanted to reunite with her father. She tried to, she married Ted Dukes. Let me tell you, she married Ted Dukes and she tried to see her father's figure in Ted Dukes, but she failed. He left her for other women. And she says that Ted Dukes sucked her blood for 7 years and he was a black man. Mm-hmm. So he failed. She failed in her attempt to find her fatherly figure in her husband. And then she tried to commit suicide, so has to join her dad. Hmm? That also failed. So all her attempts to bring back her father was brutally failed. So that is why in this poem she compares herself to a foot inside a black shoe. Hmm? For 30 years she lived in this way. She compares herself to a foot inside a black shoe. Hmm? She cannot breathe. Sneeze, she cannot do anything because her father hasn't taught her. Okay, now, yeah. So every time when she invokes her father, she got a reply in German. Oh, you. Just like in English movies, in Mummy Returns and all, people are trying to invoke and bring back the, those deities back to life. Similarly, here, Sylvia Plath also tried to bring back her father and she puts herself in such a setting in Portland, a destroyed city, distructed city in the Second World War, and she's calling her father. Hmm? She says that she was trapped. She was trapped in this present world and she compares herself to Jew. She compares her father to a Nazi and her to a Jew. Okay, now she is, this is an imaginary poem written in hallucination, okay? She's traveling to, she's traveling in a train to Austria. Austria is here described or presented as an impure or a false city. Then, in the beginning of the poem, she says that, do you know why she compares her father to a deity or a god, something like that? Because he belongs to Germany. We know that Aryan race, blue eyes, etc., etc. So that is the reason why she presented him as a god. But later, she understood that her father was not a god, but just a simple swastika, one who supported, Hitler. Actually, her father hasn't supported Hitler. All these are her imagination. Now, okay, so that's all about the poem. Now, next poem is Lady Lazarus. In Lady Lazarus, here also the another poem by our Sylvia Plath. Here she uses biblical allusions. Okay, biblical allusions. Why it is Lady Lazarus? We know that Lazarus is a biblical character, isn't it? Who was resurrected by Jesus Christ. But she has used here Lady Lazarus. Speaker is also resurrected. But the theme is entirely different. Resurrection is a happy theme. It's a positive theme, isn't it? But in this poem, resurrection is not treated as a happy in a happy tone. She really wanted to die because she just want to escape from the male-dominated oppressive society. She has been suffering for long 30 years, where she doesn't have the courage to face the problems. She was shunned by the male-dominated society. So that is why she tried to commit suicide. But every single time when she tried to commit suicide, she was saved by the dear ones or the daughters. So actually, she calls them her enemies because they have sabotaged all her attempts to escape from this oppressive world. So the theme of the poem is empowerment and hopelessness. And the metaphor, death and resurrection. I told you, resurrection is not a positive, it's not treated in a positive way in this poem, as in other poems. Okay. So motif taken from Bible. Yeah, back to life concept, resurrection. Lady Lazarus, she presented herself as a phoenix. Liberation. See, once she dies, only she can become a phoenix. Okay. But let me tell you, she says she presented entire society or entire community who tried to save her as spectators. See, as sadomasochistic. You know, I think you people are familiar with Striptease Act. In Striptease Act, a popular act in England, England and America, and almost all those kind of pop, all those of country who are having pop culture, popular culture. Striptease Act. Just Google for strip. Those who don't know, please Google for Striptease Act. Okay, fine. So she says that she is holding a striptease act for the entire society. She's performing for the society because death is an art. Death is a beautiful art. Every single time she tries that art, she is getting saved by the spectators. Who are spectators? The crowd that scrutinized her. They are the spectators. They are the people who save her. So let me tell you, crowd or the society or audience, her audience are sadomasochistic because they are taking pleasure in the suffering of other. I mean, whom do we call a sadomasochist? I mean, those people who take pleasure in the suffering of others, they are said to be sadomasochistic. Okay. See, she wanted to die, but others are saving her. So let me tell you. Again, she is presented as the Jewish theme is again brought here, because when you die, you will be wrapped in linen, just like mummies, Egyptian mummies, isn't it? So every time she tries to commit suicide, at this time, okay, I will die. But she will be saved. She will be unwrapped. That is why the Striptease Act is mentioned. What will you do while the Striptease Act? The performer will remove their dress one by one, isn't it? The performer on the stage will remove the dress one by one. Similarly, when she commits suicide, she thinks that she will be wrapped as mummy, but she will be saved. So she will be unwrapped. She will be bring back to life. She will be brought back to life again. So she says that these people are actually torturing her. Entire society is torturing her. Society doesn't like Sylvia Plath getting escaped from her problems. Actually, she sees suicide as a kind of escape. But society is not allowing her because society really want to enjoy the suffering, the way she suffers. So they are receiving some kind, society is receiving some kind of sexual gratification, isn't it? When other people suffer, certain people will get some kind of sexual gratification. So actually, our society is getting some kind of sexual gratification. So these are the major themes: death and suicide, gender and oppression, etc., etc. So I'm not reading this poem. Okay, we have discussed the Lady Lazarus theme. Now moving to Parda. Okay, Parda is an Oriental concept, isn't it? Something doesn't belong to Western society. Parda is a concept of Southeast Asian society or Eastern culture, isn't it? An exotic culture or an oriental theme. So published in 1971, Parda is about a woman behind Parda, which is a veil. So all those women, so generally we have a concept that the one behind the Parda will be immensely or very beautiful, But inside the poem, she is presenting such a woman who is murderous, vengeful, seeking revenge. Okay. Unlike the normal tradition, the woman behind this parda is very vengeful. Of course, she is beautiful, at the same time very mysterious and vengeful. Okay. So parda means a curtain or a screen. Actually, the woman in parda is none but Sylvia Plath herself. Okay. Society sees her as a beautiful woman. But behind that screen, behind that curtain, she is a wrathful woman. She wants to die. She wants to react against the oppression, male-dominated society of so-and-so. Okay. That is the main theme of Parda. So in Parda, she presents such a jade cladded, a woman in wearing jade, sitting cross-legged, sitting and smiling. Her qualities have been equated with that of moon, very sophisticated, very refined. I repeat, in Parda, just a second, let me drink some water. Yeah, Sylvia Plath presents a woman wearing jade and jade necklace, and also having a veil. She's smiling, sitting cross-legged. Then her qualities have been compared with that of moon. We know that among other planets, moon has been attributed with the romantic qualities, most polished qualities. So the one in Parda, obviously very beautiful, and having many feminine qualities, epitome of all qualities. But towards the end of the poem, we can see that she is not that refined, not that beautiful. Actually, she turns into a beast. That is the concept of Parda, the one in Parda, one in curtain, one behind the screen. Now, Ariel, the last poem. So Ariel is the swan song of our Sylvia Plath. After publishing this, she committed suicide. After publishing the collection of poems titled Ariel, she committed suicide. Now, see, here she uses Ariel with multiple connotations. So those people who are familiar with Tempest, Shakespeare's romantic comedy, Tempest, at least those people who had read Tempest, they know the name Ariel, isn't it? Ariel is a spirit in Tempest. It doesn't have any gender. It is not, neither male nor female, isn't it? Now, Ariel is also the name of Sylvia Plath. She had a host. So her host name is Ariel. So Ariel is a sexless concept. Ariel is also denote to the city of Jerusalem. It is both an impure city and also a sanctified city, a cursed at the same time sanctified city, chosen by the God, a land chosen by the God. So let me tell you, there are multiple connotations for Ariel. The first connotation, the first indication is Ariel is a sexless figure in Shakespeare's Tempest. It is through the medium of Ariel, Prospero, Shakespeare's Superman, has accomplished all his missions. Isn't it? Those people who have read Tempest, you will be knowing that. It is through Ariel that they have accomplished everything. Now, second concept is, it is the name of her host. Sylvia Plath's host name is Ariel. Now, the word Ariel also denotes to the city of Jerusalem, the city which has been regarded as the city of cursed as well as sanctified. Now, here also she presents the same theme, freedom and escape. Freedom and escape. Okay. So anyway, here horse is presented as a rebellious spirit. Sometime you will be switched with the concept of horse because she has interchanged the speaker and the horse. Okay. So here, female speaker, that is Ariel, or the, what do you call, Sylvia Plath, she wanted to get the rebellious spirit from the horse. She wanted to have the spirit of the horse, and she wanted to escape from society. And she also presents, she calls her horse as God Lioness. She has used, you must note that is a genderized term. Instead of presenting a horse as a lion, she calls it as God Lioness. She has given a female image image to that horse. Now, yes. So she is riding that horse. Okay. So that can be seen as a transformation from childhood phase to adolescent or to the adulthood phase or orgasmic awakening of adolescence, the riding on the horse, the ride on a horse. And that can be also seen as a movement, a journey from darkness to light. Let me tell you, Ariel, which is a horse in this poem, actually it stands as a rebellious spirit. Sometime the female speaker herself, okay, then a journey from darkness to light, then a transformation from childhood ignorance to orgasmic adolescent awakening, or the entire poem talks about feminist awakening. So let me tell you, in this poem, Sylvia Plath is riding that horse, her favorite horse. Its name is Ariel. So she really wanted to get some part of energy from the horse, which she presents as God Lioness. Yes, it's a genderized term because she has given female qualities to that horse, Lioness. That is why she repeatedly calls Lioness and all. Then one more thing I would like to say that. See, here she brings the story of Lady Godiva. Lady Godiva is a Saxon noblewoman of 11th century. She has revolted against her husband. She has revolted against her husband because her husband was very tyrant and he had taxed the people of England. So in order to relieve the common people, poor people, from the clutches of her husband, she dared to ride the horse naked. Her husband told Lady Godiva that he will exempt the people from the heavy taxation or the house taxation if she is ready to ride the horse naked. Anyway, she has taken up the challenge and she rode the horse naked. Let me tell you, none of the people in that town came out when she rode naked. So let me tell you, Lord Godiva is the first lady, that too from 11th century, from a highly moralistic society like England. She came out of that fetter, chain. She has broken that chain, isn't it? For the goodness of the society, she has broken that chain and freed the entire people from the cruelty of her husband. Lady Godiva, just like that, our Sylvia Plath is riding, from darkness to light, or from the confinement to freedom, or she is escaping from the brutal society. Okay, so this poem can be seen as a poem of feminist awakening or enlightenment, path towards feminist enlightenment or awakening, or like self-discovery, anything, self-identification. So far she was, she felt she was powerless. Now she understood, she equates herself with that of God. See, the last couple of poems we have learned that she is very much frustrated, very angry at her dad because she lost her power, she doesn't know how to leave, and she scolds her dad for that. But in this poem we can see that she presented her horse as well as herself as a god, and she compares it to god lioness. I hope you have understood. With that we have completed British poetry. 10 blocks have been completed. Okay, we have discussed all poems. Okay then, bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. All your sessions are very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, can I get this recording for you?
Ma'am, can you share that slide on?
Ma'am, please share the PPT.